Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming to this evening's event, and you're in for a very dynamic presentation. My name is Nepa Freeman. I'm the events coordinator here at the Institute for Policy Studies. I also engage in policy issues around US-Cuba relations, not just the analysis, but actually activists for normalizing the relationships between US and Cuba. So it is a very, it's a big honor for me to be able to introduce my brother, Miguel Fraga. We're here in the midst of a very interesting moment. About two years ago, December 17th, 2014, was the first public announcement of the U.S. and Cuba engaging in the process of normalizing relations. It was the start of diplomatic relations opening up. And as you know, since that time, the U.S. has gone through some an election. And so the prospects for the continuing of that are up in the air. Very interesting things. We have seen a lot of changes in between that time and now. Most of them are the result of the executive order by the United States, by President Obama, in terms of U.S. policy toward Cuba. A lot of that is, it's good. And in fact, just was it yesterday or the day before, it was announced that the U.S. was going to stop the wet foot, dry foot policy. I don't know how many people are familiar with that, but it's a very, exceptional policy that no other country has. When people come to the United States, when they migrate here to the United States, how they get here, it's it gives special treatment to people who come from Cuba as soon as they land on U.S. soil that no other immigrants would get, regardless of how they come, being through legal or illegal means. And so that's a very interesting thing that is actually the policy has caused and a number of policies, but that policy has caused or instigated very unsafe migration from here, from Cuba to the United States. And so it's a very good thing that that's been undone. Without further ado, I'm just gonna let Miguel get into his presentation. It's a very informative presentation, and I appreciate the way the brother's actually very engaging and somewhat has some little bit of comic relief in the way he presents things to us. Miguel Fraga was appointed first secretary in June 2015 to the Cuban Interest Section, which is now the Embassy of Cuba right here in Washington, D.C. In 2006, he has worked at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in both the North American and U.S. divisions in the Office of the Minister, served at the Cuban Embassy in Canada, and as a member of the People's Power Provincial Assembly of the City of Havana, and graduated summa cum laude from the University of Havana Faculty of Law. And he also has a Master's of Science in Foreign Relations. Without further ado, we give you Miguel Fraga.
Thank you so much.
And we will have enough time to be able to engage with Miguel after the presentation.
Well, good evening. Thank you so much for coming. It's a real pleasure for me to be here. I always say I'm sorry for my English. Probably I need to improve, but this is a good opportunity to practice. I know that you are very brave. You are here to listen from a Cuban, you know. We are very famous for long speeches. So, but don't worry. Don't worry, I'm not going to break any record tonight. But it's a real pleasure to be here. And I can say, Nefa, as Rocky, we did it. Because after two years here in DC, I am finally here in EPS. I am very proud to be here with all of you talking about Cuba and United States. After 2 years, we have accomplished a lot. Unfortunately, I believe that there is not enough information about Cuba. So my presentation is going to be about Cuba, about United States and Cuba relations, what we have accomplished in the last 2 years and how we see the future. And of course, if you have any questions, feel free. People believe that as diplomats, you are experts in everything and people want to know about everything. If I don't have the answer, I will get back to you in the future. But this is, you can see that we have a lot of history together. This is, of course, Washington Memorial here in DC, and this is Jose Marti Memorial in Havana. You see how similar they are. And again, we have a lot of history together. So I always start with some questions. Let's see. Probably this froze. Okay. I have some opening questions for you. And my first question is, what do you know about Cuba? I believe this is very important. If you go and read the media right now, everything or the majority of things are bad things about Cuba. And when you ask to people, what do you know about Cuba? If people is polite, they always say, okay, Cuba is famous because cigars, because rum. Some people say Fidel. But when you ask, what do you really know about Cuba? People don't have information about Cuba. I remember one time in American University, I asked, what do you know about Cuba? And one student told me, I know about Cuba. I said, what do you know? And he said, I know I love Lucy, the TV series show back from the 50s. And I say, wow, you missed the last 50 years. And that is the other problem. People know about Bay of Pigs. People know about the missiles crisis, but they don't know enough information about what is happening in Cuba, what is Cuba. Would you like to visit Cuba? You can raise your hand. How many of you want to go to Cuba? Okay, that is a good support. That's good. Excellent. Next question. Do you consider that Cuba and the United States can have normal relations? The real question is, why not? What is the real excuse? Oh, because we are communists? United States has wonderful relations with communist countries. Good trade relations, good diplomatic relations. Oh, because we only have one political party? United States has good relations with countries that don't allow political parties. So what is the real excuse to don't have normal relations between Cuba and United States? Have you been in Cuba? How many of you? Raise your hands. Okay, now you see the difference. People want to go there, but the majority of people has not been able to visit Cuba. So what do you know about Cuba is what you read in the media. And that is my final question. Do you consider that Cuba receives fair treatment in the media? That is for the end. That is for the end of my presentation. If at the end of my presentation, you already knew about everything I'm going to present, we can say that we receive fair treatment in the media, but probably you didn't know before. Okay, let's start with this quote. Why the Cuban Revolution? Why the Cuban made a revolution in 1959? I'm going to start with this. I believe that there is no country in the world, including any and all the countries under colonial domination, where economic colonization, humiliation, and exploitation were worse than in Cuba, in part owing to my country's policy during the Batista regime. Batista was the former dictator of Cuba. I approve the proclamation with Fidel Castro made in the Sierra Maestra when he justified a call for justice and especially yearned to write Cuba off corruption. I will even go further. To some extent, it is as though Batista was the incarnation of a number of sins on the part of the United States. Now we should have to pay for those sins. In the matter of the Batista regime, I am in agreement with the first Cuban revolutionaries. That is perfectly clear. Do you know who said that? Do you have any idea who said that? Okay, let me help. This was October 24, 1963, and was President Kennedy. You don't read that in the media very often. I'm sure about that. And this was an interview, as you see, 1 month before he was shot in Dallas, Texas. And this is the man that approved Bay of Pigs. This is the man that deals with the Cuban missiles crisis. But according to many sources, at this time, he was working to improve the relation between Cuba and the United States. And I believe it's very important to read what he saw about Cuba. And when he mentioned Cuba out of corruption, I always say, if you want to know what was Cuba before the revolution, you need to see The Godfather, second part. Do you remember the movie? The mob in Cuba trying to create a new Las Vegas? Okay, that was the idea why we did a revolution. So when you compare Cuba now, when Cuba before 1959, you see why we made the revolution. What was the idea behind the revolution? So what is Cuba? The majority of the numbers I'm going to use are from the World Bank. So you can check it in the World Bank website. And the most important, if you don't believe me, go to Cuba. That is my special advice. We are 11.2 million. We are smaller than Pennsylvania. Our GDP is $77 billion, according again to the World Bank. We are number 67 among 195 countries, according to our GDP and the World Bank in 2015. We have 5 million of workers in Cuba. And right now, according to our numbers, almost 10%, 500,000 work in the private sector. For those to say that Cuba don't change nothing, that number was not even close in the last 10 years. And now we have 500,000 of workers that work in the private sector. And this is not a concession. This is what the majority of Cuba wants, to improve many things in the economy in Cuba. And our per capita income is, according to the World Bank, 6,700 million of dollars. In 2013 is the last number that they have. So every time that you heard that Cuba live with, the Cubans live with $20 per day, that is not true. And our $20 is not your $20. That is something that's very important to understand. And another thing we are proud, life expectancy, 79 years old. Birth attended by skilled health staff, 100%. Mortality rate for less than 4 or 4.5 in the last year, I believe. Immunization, 99% of our children receive all the vaccines for free. All the vaccine. The 1% that don't receive vaccine is because religious reasons, they don't want it, and we respect that. We have 6.7 doctors per 1,000 people. According to the World Health Organization, this is United Nations, 44% of the states that are members of this organization only have less than one doctor, and we have 6.7. 100% of the Cuban population knows how to read and write, and the majority goes all the way through the university because it's for free. We don't know what is to graduate with debt because we don't have nothing like that. And remember, right now we have 700 million that people that don't know how to read and write in the world right now. 95% of the Cuban population has access to improved water sources, and 93% has access to improved sanitation facilities. Again, this is the World Bank, you can check it. Education. In 2010, we spent 12.8% of our GDP on education, 12.8%. According to the World Bank in that year, that was the highest investment in education worldwide. Health, we spent 8% of our GDP in health. This number is from this year and it's our sources. To health and education, we allocate 51% of total expenditure of 2017 budget activity. So more than half. And in the military, we only spend 3.5% of our GDP. So we know why are our priorities. And for the end, according to the United Nations, we are an upper middle income country. So we are not... We don't know what is the extreme poverty. We don't know nothing like that. We don't have our GDP. When you compare our GDP with the G7, okay, but we are very proud of those things I mentioned before with small resources that we have. And also with embargo, I'm going to explain that after. This is the Human Development Index from the United Nations. And according to this index, we are number 67 out of 188 countries. I always say it's not fair to compare Cuba with the G7 countries. But even when you compare Cuba with the G7 countries, you're going to see numbers that are very good, but we don't have the same resources. But when you compare Cuba with the rest of Latin America, Asia, Africa, you're going to see that we are fine with many things. Of course, if you ask to a Cuban, every Cuban wants to improve many things. And we can change many things, but that is a decision for the majority of the Cubans. Let's continue. More things to be proud of. I love sports, and sports are very expensive. Probably you know that. Let me see. And this is Cuba in the Olympic Games. We have won 220 Olympic medals, 77 gold medals. That's a small country. And when you see that before the Cuban Revolution, I believe we only have 9 medals. And now we have 220. So another thing that we are proud. Baseball. I love baseball. And I know United States love baseball. And by the way, I was in Alabama, in Spring Hill College in Alabama, in Mobile, Alabama. They have this story about two Cuban brothers in the 19th century who learned baseball there, and they bring back baseball to Cuba. Now, baseball is the national sport of the Cubans. But in any case, right now, 199 players born in Cuba has played in Major League Baseball. The first was in 1871, Esteban Bayan. So it's nothing new to have good ball players from Cuba here in the major leagues. In opening day last year, 2015, Cuba was number 3 with 18 players born outside the US. And I had the opportunity to visit the Hall of Fame, and you have 312 people in the Hall of Fame in Cooperstown. 9 are Latinos, 4 are Cubans. And look at this, since 2010, big league teams have signed at least 25 Cuban players to major league contracts worth at least $1 million for a grand total of $645 million. What is the problem? In order to play in the United States, the Cuban has to defect. They have to sign a letter that say, I'm not going back to Cuba, I'm not going to bring back money to Cuba. So those $645 million never went to Cuba. And for that reason, we have in the last Congress a bill. A US congressman from New York, Jose Serrano, introduced this bill to allow Cubans to play here in Major League Baseball and go back to Cuba. And right now, by the way, in the 115th Congress, we have a new bill, the 573, that is only to waive certain prohibition with respect to nationals of Cuba coming to the United States to play organized professional baseball. So it's the only country that have these problems in the world. More information about Cuba. I love Twitter. You know, probably you love too, but the idea is that you have to put all your ideas in 140 characters. So that is a challenge. And I always try to look information in Twitter, and this is the NASA historian account. And they say, happy birthday to Arnaldo Tamayo Mendez of Cuba, first Latin American and first person of African ancestry in space. What's a Cuban? Another information, last year, Cuba is the first country in the world to receive World Health Organization validation for eliminating mother to child transmission of HIV and syphilis. Cuba, that's a small country, that country with not enough resources. According to the WWF, Cuba is the only country in the world today that meets the criteria for sustainable development. And this, according to UNICEF from the United Nations, Cuba has eliminated severe child malnutrition. It's the only country in the Latin America that has eliminated the severe child malnutrition. So this is something I put now because everybody say, okay, what about internet? The Cubans don't want internet. The Cuban government don't allow internet in Cuba. Well, according to this information, right now we have more than 1,000 public spaces in Cuba for internet, and we have more than 200 Wi-Fi zones in Cuba. That is a huge change in the last year. And right now we start internet at home. Of course, we don't have the infrastructure, we don't have the technology, it's very expensive, it's very slow, but this is not about that we don't want internet in Cuba. The problem is that before we didn't have the opportunity to connect to the cables that surround the island. And for the first time we have that opportunity, and we are trying to improve the access to internet in Cuba. And according to our numbers, at least 250,000 of Cubans use internet daily in points Wi-Fi. And if you go right now to Cuba, you're going to see a lot of young people doing Twitter, doing Facebook, doing wherever. And it's very interesting. But I saw internet back in the 90s when I was in the university. A very slow internet, but for free in the university. Of course, I use it to know what is happening here in the Major League Baseball, not to do research. But in any case, was my first approach to internet. But the problem is not Cuba. According to the United Nations, the majority of the world population don't have access to internet. So when you say, oh, the Cubans don't have internet, okay. Only 43.3% of the human people have internet right now. Why the problem is Cuba? Okay. And this was the other day when President Obama announced the new opportunities with Cuba in October. This is the journalist from CNN in Havana. For those who say, but who is in Havana? Oh, we have a journalist from CNN. And he put in his Twitter account, ha, trying to watch a Susan Rice webcast on loosening of Cuba restriction, but getting a prohibited location error message. So who is blocking internet? It's not Cuba. And I replied to him in my Twitter account. This proves at least three things. The embargo is still in place. There is internet in Cuba and it's limited by the same embargo. He never replied to me, by the way. Our key trading partners, you can see Venezuela, Canada, Netherlands, and China in the exports and in the imports. We have Venezuela, China, Spain, and Brazil. So when people come to us and say, how is to do business with Cuba? I always reply, ask the Canadians. We have been doing business with all the world. The problem is the embargo. And the problem is that we didn't have the opportunity before to do business with the United States. But we have been doing business with all the world. Well, Cuba is not isolated anymore. Right now, we have diplomatic relations with 191 countries, orders, and institutions, 190 of the 193 United Nations member states. Remember, at the beginning of the revolution, only Canada and Mexico keep their relation with Cuba in the Western Hemisphere. And now we have embassies. Relation with all the countries, 190 of the 193 United Nations member states. And we have 114 foreign diplomatic missions in Cuba. That is a huge number. You can compare it with the G7. And probably they don't have so many embassies in their countries. But also we have 122 Cuban embassies and missions abroad. That is another huge number. We have embassies almost everywhere. Of course, a Cuban embassy sometimes is a house with a flag and two people inside working hard. We don't need a big budget. And don't worry, I always say, we don't have only two people here in DC, we have more people. But in some countries, we only have that. But we are working everywhere. And about cooperation, look at this number. More than 300,000 collaborators have provided service in 158 countries in the last 50 years. So we have been trying to cooperate with all the countries in the world. Right now, we have more than 50,000 Cuban healthcare workers providing service in 65 nations, and more than 50% are doctors. That is a huge number. Every time that people say, okay, you send doctors to Venezuela because the oil, I reply, why we send doctors to Haiti? Why we send doctors to Africa? Okay, we have with Venezuela cooperation, and we have doctors in Venezuela, but it's not only in Venezuela. We have been working in Haiti for the last 10 years, 12 years, I don't know. Before the earthquake, we have doctors there. I remember during the earthquake, every day they put here in the news how many doctors sent this country and how many doctors sent that country and how many help. And one line about Cuba said, okay, Cuba sent, I don't remember, 40, 20 doctors. I said, you know what? Because we had 400 doctors before the earthquake. So we don't need to send more doctors. We had 400 before. And look at this. Since to the Yes I Can educational program, almost 10 million people have left illiteracy behind in 30 different countries right now. And more than 68,000 students from 157 countries have graduated in Cuba. Some of them are from the United States. You know that we have this School of Medicine that is very famous, is the land And we have a student from 117 countries in that school, and more than 25 South and medical graduated from 84 countries. Again, some of them from the United States. And let me say this right now. I don't come here to say that we are perfect. I don't come here to say that you have to do what we do every day. I come here to say that we are not so bad, that you don't know what is the real Cuba, and that we are very proud of many things, and we can work together to improve many things in the world. That is my only idea. The problem is that there is a lot of misinformation about my country. And for that reason, you don't read this every day. The only thing that you hear is about democracy and human rights. And I'm going to talk about that, don't worry. So, more information. This is 2 years ago. This was 2014. For the first time in the New York Times, you read an editorial about the Cuban Embassy's role on Ebola. And look what they say. That was the first time in many, many years. They say, Cuba has a long tradition of dispatching doctors and nurses to disaster areas abroad. In the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina in 2005, the Cuban government created a quick reaction medical corps and offered to send doctors to New Orleans. The United States didn't take Havana up on that offer. I remember at that time they said, oh, this is politics. We had ready 1,000 doctors to send to New Orleans. Unfortunately, after that, we had the earthquake in Pakistan. We had the earthquake in Pakistan. And Pakistan asked for help, and we sent those doctors to Pakistan. At that time, we didn't have diplomatic relations with Pakistan. But was great to see that in the New York Times here. And I put this in my Twitter account, what Fidel said at that time, our former president. And you can see here, September 19, 2005, in the middle of the Katrina, he said, there is nothing strange about the behavior of Cuba, which does not hesitate to offer the people of the United States the immediate dispatch of experienced doctors with the essential resources needed to administer emergency care to people in mortal danger following a serious natural disaster. Also, our country was closest to the area hit by the hurricane and was in the position to send over human and material aid in a matter of hours. Do you hear about the last hurricane? How many people died in Haiti? Last time I heard, more than 400 people died. How many people died here in the United States? 20. I believe the last time, the last hurricane, the Matthew, how many people died here? Around 20, I believe. How many people died in Cuba? Nobody. You can check it. Try to find. If something wrong happening in Cuba, you're going to read it in the front page of almost every newspaper here. But if something good happened, no. Nobody talks about that. So, Cuba and United States, everything start December the 17th. President Raul Castro and President Obama announced to the world they are ready to start a new moment of the relations between Cuba and United States, December the 17th. 2014. This is our national newspaper, Grama. And you can see we published both speeches in the front page. So everybody was able to read what President Obama said in the Oval, in the White House. I was trying to find any newspaper here in the United States that published the speech of Raul. I didn't find anyone. So you can see here, it's the New York Times, and you can see Fidel in the front page, not even Raul. And Fidel was not longer in power since 2006. But in any case, of course, for us, a very important news was also the release of the three of the Cuban Five, you know? And by the way, today is a very historic day. I don't know if you read about President Obama grants pardon to Oscar Lopez Rivera and also to Chelsea Manning. That is the news today. Well, why this happened? Why this new moment between Cuba and United States? Well, let me tell you that I have been told that you here in the United States love polls. You you always want to know what people say about something. So every poll before December the 17th and after December the 17th, American polls, shows that the majority of the American people wants better relations with Cuba. And I can show you right now, six of those polls. You can see here, two before December the 17th and another three after December the 17th. Sorry, I'm going to show a lot of polls. And people say, why so many numbers? And okay, because in the majority, in all the polls, you can see that the majority wants better relations. And these two are very interesting because these are before December the 17th. But I want to put the attention here in Florida International University. We have 2 million of Cuban Americans living here in the United States. The majority, 1.2 million, live in Florida and in Miami-Dade County. And this poll from the Florida International University said in June 2014 that 68% of Cuban Americans in Miami-Dade County support normalizing relations with Cuba. And 71% expressed the view that the embargo was not working at all or not very well. But you can see this, the same here in the Americans. 56% of Americans and more than 60% of Floridian and Latinos favor change U.S. policy toward Cuba. Washington Post, ABC News, 68% support ending the trade embargo. And this is December. This is after the announcement. So the support is very clear. You have here another poll. This is very interesting. In April, more support, 51-40. And this is something interesting because this enterprise do a poll for the Washington poll post in Cuba, and it's the only poll I know that was done in Cuba. And according to this poll, 96% of the Cubans think the embargo should be eliminated. 96% should consider that the embargo should be eliminated. And here another poll in June, 40% of the Cuban American voters will be willing to support a candidate favoring a normalization of relations. Only 26% are less inclined to vote for that candidate. So we start negotiations between Cuba and United States. The good news is we have women in charge from Cuba and from United States. And we had this the first meeting, official meeting between a Minister of Foreign Affairs of Cuba and a U.S. Secretary of State. This was in Panama during the Summit of the Americas. And after that, we have this historic moment, President Raul, President Obama, shake hand. Nothing but happened. We are still here, you see? And we open embassies, our embassy here in D.C. and your embassy in Havana. And after that, we have also this another historic moment in United Nations here in New York. What happened? Nothing. Two countries sit down, try to find ways to improve their relations, and we are still here. Another important moment. In May 29, 2015, the White House announced that we are pleased to know that today the Secretary of State has rescinded Cuba designation as a state sponsor of terrorism. So you are not here with a terrorism. Because for many years, we were in that list. Since the 80s, we were in that list. Nevertheless, there are not a single evidence that we commit any crime against the United States. And I know how important terrorism is for United States. I have been able to visit New York City, to visit, of course, Arlington, and to visit also the place when the Flight 93 crashed in Pennsylvania. But you know what? Cubans know very much about terrorism. On September 11, 1980, a Cuban diplomat was shot and killed in New York. Probably you don't know nothing about that, but you can put it in Google and you're going to find the information. So it's the day that Cuban paid tribute to the fallen in the foreign service. And we know what means to use a plane to commit terrorist actions. In October 6, 1976, two terrorists paid to put a bomb in a Cuban plane, civil plane, and they killed 73 passengers. One of them is still in Miami, free. One person that organized this. So we know what is terrorism. We have suffered terrorists for many years. But again, and let me say this, because yes, we are proud to send doctors, to send teachers, and we are proud to send soldiers to Africa during the 70s, during the 80s. And if you want to know more about that, read what Nelson Mandela said about Cuba. For many years, Nelson Mandela was considered a terrorist. Now he's a symbol of freedom. But read what Nelson Mandela said about Cuba. And again, there is not a single evidence that we commit any crime against the United States. But now, here in EPS, I want to show a proof that a foreign country commit terrorism here in the United States and nothing happened. According to this secret memorandum, CIA report, Pinochet, the former dictator of Chile, personally ordered Washington car bombing who killed Orlando Letelier, the former Minister of Foreign Affairs of Chile. And you can read, this is the source. You can see the memo here, and you can find more information online. But this is what the memo say. This is Secretaries of State of the United States, Chul, wrote to President Reagan, "Nevertheless, this is a blatant example of a chief of state direct involvement in an act of state terrorism, one that is particularly disturbing, both because it's occurred in our capital and since his government is generally considered to be friendly." So, Augusto Pinochet personally ordered his intelligence chief to carry out the murder of Orlando Letelier. And when they put the bomb and they kill Letelier, they also kill a US citizen, Murphy, his secretary, yes, here. So this is the place to talk about that. And never United States put an embargo to Chile. Never put Chile in the state of a sponsor of terrorism. And that is another thing I want to stress today. If you want to talk about dictatorship, you have to ask to the Chileans, who was Pinochet? You need to ask to the people in Nicaragua, who was Somoza? You need to ask to the people in Cuba, who was Batista? So it's interesting to see the so-called dissidents in Cuba that comes here to explain how bad the things are in Cuba and go back to Cuba to spend the money that the US government put in his hands. So it's interesting to talk about that. Another historic moment. Of course, you know the place, you know one of the person. The other one is my ambassador. For the first time since 1959, a Cuban ambassador present credential to a US president. And this was an historic moment in 2015. This is our embassy. It's in 16th Street, very near. And according to the DC authorities, it's the oldest building as an embassy right now in DC, because the one that opened before changed the location. And a little bit of history. This was the person that start the construction of the building that is 100 years old. And this was the first ambassador of Cuba with that title in between 1923 and 1925. So, well, more polls. After we reopen our embassy, after President Obama shake hands with President Raul, we have here more polls. Sure. Sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. Let me go back. Okay, let me see, one more. Okay, two more polls. Here, this is from the Atlantic Council. And always remember, these are American polls. So it's not Cuban propaganda. And this, you can see in Iowa, Indiana, Ohio, and Tennessee, 70% believe the United States is in the wrong track. But those same people believe support in 68% the ties with Cuba. So I always say, I don't have the number for DC, but I have been able to travel around the US and I have been able to see that this is real people. When you go and ask about Cuba, people is okay with Cuba. And this is another important poll. You can see here between 1996 and 2016, And you can see in 1996, 81% of the U.S. population have a bad opinion about Cuba. And this is coming down, and this opinion is going up. For the first time, 54% of the American population have a good opinion about Cuba. And why this is important? First, because it's people that don't know, don't have good information about Cuba. And the majority is people that have not been able to travel to Cuba. So imagine if we have more Americans traveling to Cuba. Those numbers are going up very easy. Because when you ask to the people that goes to Cuba, what do you think? People are going to say, okay, Cuba is a great country. Cuba, the music, this and that. I saw the other day this actor, I don't remember, Footloose, the movie. He was in Cuba. He was happy with, and he was in this show talking about his trip to Cuba and saying, Cuba is wonderful. I remember one person that comes to me and say, I believe that Cuba was a country with everybody was in the street with guns and everybody was a military in green uniform. And I say, no, that is not Cuba. But that is the image that you have here, unfortunately. So what else? In the last 2 years, we have five members of the cabinet that has traveled to Cuba. We are talking about the Secretary of State, Secretary of Commerce, Secretary of Agriculture, Transportation, and also Health and Human Service have traveled to Cuba. We have 10 members of the Senate and more or less 43 members of the House from both parties. We have 7 governors, Governor of New York, Arkansas, Texas, Virginia, Missouri, Louisiana, and West Virginia. And you can read what they say after the trip. Oh, we have opportunities in Cuba. We can have more things to do. The Secretary of Transportation was in the first direct flight to our country. That is another thing that we can show right now after the 2 years that we have improved. Sorry. So right now we are talking about many issues. For the first time, we're talking about environment, we are talking about law enforcement, we are talking about mail, we are talking about claims. I know how important is claims for some people here in the United States. And let me tell you this, Cuba has already negotiated bilateral settlements of outstanding property claims with other governments, because people say, oh, the problem was that Fidel Castro took the properties and he doesn't pay to anybody. No, we don't only took U.S. property, we nationalized properties in Cuba, but we had agreements with Canada in 1980, with Great Britain in 1978, with France in 1967, with Spain and Switzerland. The problem was that the United States refused to negotiate with Cuba. They want the money before in front, and was not possible. And this is a long history again. We are talking about human rights, because we have concerns about human rights, of course. We are talking about global health. For the first time, Cuba and the United States worked together in Africa against Ebola. That was something that proved that we can help other countries, and probably we can do the same in Haiti. We are talking about travel. We are talking about commerce. We are talking about internet and telecommunications, security and trade, of trade and travel flow. And we are talking, of course, about the Colombia pit stall, because probably you know that we are hosting those important conversations in Havana. And we create a bilateral commission. And until yesterday, we have signed 18 bilateral agreements between Cuba and United States. About what? About many of these issues. We have signed agreements that prove that we can work together. 24 high-level visits, 17 from the US and 7 from Cuba. 42 technical meetings and cooperation activities. And we can do more, for sure, in the future. So we have normal relations? No. We have diplomatic relations, but we don't have normal relations. Why? This is my ambassador. Last year, during our National Day, I quote, "In Cuba, we believe that bilateral relations with the United States will be normal only when we exercise full sovereignty on all our territory when we are no longer under the sanction regime and when no specific programs are funded to alter our way of life. And that is something very important that I want to stress here. We don't have normal relations. The embargo is still in place. Guantanamo is there. You are sending money, taxpayer money, to overthrow the Cuban government. I'm going to show that right now. That when you talk about the embargo, people don't know. But more than 70% of the Cuban population don't know another reality. The reality that they know is to live under the embargo. What that means? What the embargo means? Well, you can see this, and this is a memorandum that was secret. And this was a memorandum from 1960. We declared that we were socialists in 1961. But this is a secret memorandum, and you can find that right now it's online because they published in 1991 this Foreign Relations of the United States, Volume 6, Cuba. So it was secret between 1960 and 1991. But now it's public, you can check it online. What the memorandum say? Number one, the majority of Cuban support Castro. The lowest estimate I have seen is 50%. I don't know you, but a government with 50% of support has at least the half of the country. Point number two, there is not effective political opposition. Okay, let's go to the point number six. We need to alienate internal support. How? Well, we need to create dissentiment and disaffection based on economic disaffection and hardship. And how they propose to do that? You can go directly to the last two lines. We need to deny money and supplies to Cuba to decrease monetary and real wage to bring about hunger, desperation, and overthrow of the government. So a government that at least has 50% of support, a country that when you don't find political opposition and you want to create hunger, desperation, and overthrow of the government, that was the idea behind the embargo. That is what the embargo wants to create in Cuba. And unfortunately, the embargo is still in place because the president cannot change the embargo. We need Congress, and I'm going to explain that. But I want that you know that this is right now online. You can read it every time that you want in this Office of the Historian, Bureau of Public Affairs. For us, it's good that the embargo is not a bilateral issue anymore. Last year in United Nations, for the first time, but the 25th in a row, the United Nations General Assembly approved a resolution that asked to the United States to lift the embargo. What happened last year? 191 countries vote in favor, and the two other countries, United States and Israel, abstention. So right now, every country in the world is against the embargo. You can see here the score of the General Assembly. You can see all the countries in green, only Israel and United States abstention. I remember one person here, United States, that say to me, I don't trust in the United Nations. There's so many problems in that. And I say, okay, how many times do you see the whole world supporting one cause? And here, we are talking about the whole world. So the application of the embargo, of the blockade, has caused damage to Cuba. I cannot say that number. $125 billion. But last year, and remember this number, last year, the embargo cost to Cuba $4.6 billion. That doesn't mean that we don't have that money. That means that we have to spend that money because of the embargo. And for example, that cost to Cuba $82 million in health, $1 million in education, and $29 million in culture and sports. That is the cost of the embargo. People don't understand what that means. But let me tell you this. We cannot buy many things here in the United States. So we have to buy in other countries. And people know that we cannot buy here, so they charge extra. For the first time, President Obama changed the policy, but since 1992, you have a law here in the United States that say that if a ship goes to Cuba, needs to wait 6 months to come to the United States. Imagine. We are an island. We need chips to bring the things that we buy abroad. And sometimes we have to pay extra. That is the meaning of the embargo. That is what it means to Cubans. And for those who say, what is the embargo? Since December the 17th, United States government has fined 11 entities, 11 enterprise, banks, whatever, 7 American and 4 foreigners for a cumulative value of $2,623,359. And you can check that in the Department of Treasury in the OFAC, Office of Foreign Affairs, Asset Control. So that is the embargo, right? The last fine was to this bank in Canada, the Toronto Dominion Bank, TD Bank. They have to pay millions of dollars for doing business with Cuba. What that means? That banks don't want to do business with us anymore. And banks that do business with Cuba charge extra, and we have to pay more. That is the meaning of the embargo. And you can check it online if you want, again. This was the President's State of the Union last year, his last State of the Union. Look at this. 50 years of isolating Cuba had failed to promote democracy and set us back in Latin America. That's why we restored diplomatic relations. Applause. This is not for you. This is what happened in the House, you know? Opening the door to travel and commerce, positioning ourselves to improve the life of the Cuban people. Applause. So if you want to consolidate our leadership and credibility in the hemisphere, recognize that the Cold War is over. Lift the embargo. Applause. Let me ask you this. So far, according to all the polls, the majority of Americans don't want the embargo. The Cuban Americans don't want the embargo. Any country in the world is asking to lift the embargo. The president is asking to lift the embargo. Why the embargo is still in place? And who, the people who support the embargo, who they represent? Because they cannot say anymore that they are representing the majority of the American or the majority of the Cuban American or they have the support of the world. So that's something that I want that you think about, you know? So, Guantanamo. I don't know what you know about Guantanamo, but let me tell you, this is very simple. It's part of our territory. We want it back. You can see the island and you can see the Bay of Guantanamo. Here, this is the territory that unfortunately has been occupied since 1903, I believe. The US has leased Guantanamo Bay from Cuba since 1903. The land belongs to Cuba, but the original agreement based on the Platt Amendment gives the United States complete jurisdiction and control over the base. This was the senator behind, Senator Bill Platt from Connecticut behind this Platt Amendment. You need to go back in your history lessons in high school, probably. Do you remember the Spanish-American War? The war was not in Spain, was not here in the United States, but the name is Spanish-American War. The war was in Cuba, in the Philippines, in Puerto Rico, but the name is Spanish-American War. Well, after that war, United States occupied Cuba. And that military occupation, they ordered to our people to write the first Cuban constitution. And the governor, a person from the military, say to the people that was writing the constitution, so if you want to have a republic, you have to approve the Platt Amendment as part of the constitution. Otherwise, we're going to stay here and occupy the island. So that was in a vote, and in a split decision, the Cubans decide to have the republic with the Platt Amendment in order to have the republic. But since to that, we have Guantanamo Bay right now there. And another agreement in 1934 gave the United States the use of Guantanamo in perpetuity. So people ask, when the United States is going to leave? Never. They can be there forever. Unless the United States unilaterally abandon the base, or both the United States and Cuba agree to end the lease. And by the way, the space that you have right now in Guantanamo is 2 times the territory of Manhattan. You know how much do you pay for Guantanamo? You have any idea how much do you pay for Guantanamo? you pay $4,085 per year. Somebody told me probably that is what one apartment in Manhattan costs, 1 month. And again, this is not about the money. We don't want millions. We never collect the check after the revolution. Only one time it was a mistake. Because we don't want the money, we want the land. It's our land, you know? We don't want any base in Cuba. But this is interesting. Well, subversion and destabilization. According to this report, and this is from the Congressional Research Service, between 1996 and 2014, Congress appropriated some $264 million in funding for Cuban democracy efforts. So you have been paying to create political opposition in Cuba, to create political opposition in Cuba, and not to create a school, not to create hospital, to create political opposition in Cuba. I always say, for some people, this is a way of life. For that reason, you have people here that defend the embargo, that defend to create this. And this was a bill that was in Congress last year, in the last Congress. This was HR 570. I don't know if you know what is Radio Martí, TV Martí, Martí Noticias. José Martí is our national hero. So in 1980s, President Reagan created a radio with the name of our national hero to broadcast propaganda against Cuba. Imagine if we create Radio Washington and we broadcast communist propaganda against the United States. It's what you do every day. And in the 90s, you create a TV station and now you have a website. You know how much that costs to you? According to this congresswoman, so it's not Cuban, she's a congresswoman, she said that you have paid $770 million for that in the last 30 years. And last year, only last year, that cost to you $27 million. And let me tell you something, you're losing money because nobody sees TV Martí, nobody listens to Radio Martí. And probably you can use that money better, you know? Just one idea. Again, sorry, I have to be quick for the time. But the idea is that we need Congress to change the law. Right now, Cuba is the only country that you need a license to travel. You can go to all the countries in the world, even countries that you have a war right now. But you cannot go to Cuba. You need a license. Why? Why? So we had last year two bills in Congress about freedom to travel. And in the Senate, we have 53 senators co-sponsored that bill. And we have 131 members that co-sponsored the Travel to Cuba Act. Of course, we have another bills about trade, because again, we have opportunities for both sides. But right now, in the 115th Congress, we already have one bill, 351 HR, that is about freedom to travel to Cuba. And we have another bills about lifting the trade embargo and lifting the embargo in general. So the idea is we need Congress to change what is happening. And let me show you this, because I always say, this is not only good for Cubans, this is also good for the United States. This is the Department of Agriculture here in the United States, and you can see this in its website. And you can see that according to United Nations, we buy 70 to 80% of our food abroad. We are talking about $2 billion of dollars every year that we buy in food. Because the embargo is in place, it's prohibited by law to give credits to Cuba to buy agricultural products here. So in 2008, we buy $658 million here in the United States. But because it's prohibited to have credit here, we only buy $300 million in 2014. So the farmers want to sell products to Cuba, and we buy we want to buy more products. And remember, we are talking that we buy $2 billion of dollars in food. But you remember how much cost the embargo to us? $4 billion. So we can have more money to buy more products, and it's money in the pocket of the farmer and it's food in our table. So, but we have also these opportunities for cooperation and help. According to this organization, and this organization is for California, numerous Cuban innovations are helping patients worldwide, but not in the US. We have, for example, this medicine, these products that help to prevent the amputation of the foot if you have diabetes, According to your numbers, you have 20 million of people in the United States that suffer from diabetes. And according to this number, 75,000 of them will require amputation from diabetic foot ulcers. We have a medication that you can use, but we need a license for that. And of course, you cannot travel to Cuba to have access to our health care. You know who goes to Cuba to have access to our health care? The Cuban Americans. You can read it in the New York Times, in the New Herald, if you want it. But since to President Obama, he changed in October 14 the policy, and he gave permission. And for the first time, this is Roswell Park. It's an institute very well known in New York. And they put in the Twitter account, history is being made today. We are proud to announce the launch of the first US clinical trial for Simavax, a Cuban-made lung cancer vaccine. This was on October 26, 2016, last year, very recently, the first trials. And this is from last week, January 9. The University of Illinois in Chicago announced that they welcome a Cuban health officials to Chicago, and they want to launch a partnership to improve the community-based care. So we have three doctors in Chicago to try to provide better health care to the people that don't have enough money in Chicago. We can do that in many more places because we don't need a big amount of money to do that. So that is something that is happening right now. This was the historic visit of President Obama to Cuba. You can see everything almost there. And what he said, I believe, is very important. As President of the United States, I have called on our Congress to lift the embargo. And people applaud there in Cuba. It is an outdated burden of the Cuban people. It's a burden of the American who wants to work and do business or invest here in Cuba. It's time to lift the embargo. And he also say, I have made it clear that the United States has neither the capacity nor the intention to impose change on Cuba. What change comes will depend upon the Cuban people. That is the only thing that we want, to decide our own future. That was the historic photo. But look at this, another poll. This is New York Times. 6 in 10 Americans think restoring diplomacy with Cuba is mostly good for the US. You know, the last president that visited Cuba was in 1928. President Coolidge. Is somebody here from 1928? I don't think so. I remember President Obama said in Cuba, okay, the last president who visited Cuba needs 3 days to come. I only need 3 hours. 3 hours. Nothing happened, you know? Good. Well, already we are breaking barriers. We have, for the first time in more than 50 years, let's see, the cruise to Cuba. We also have the flights to Cuba. We already have 2 hotels. Running by a US company. People say, what do you think about that? Well, we have 20 hotels running by a Spanish company. Why not 2 hotels by an American company? Of course, with respect. We are not going to open the door to everything. We are going to try to find opportunities that are good for the majority of our people. Why not? And we already have agreements with the mayor companies here. You can see Spring, T-Mobile, AT&T, and Verizon. And we already signed an agreement with Google to improve the speed of the internet in Cuba. But again, it's not an agreement to allow Google to do whatever they want. No, it's only to improve the access to internet in Cuba because we are not afraid of that. And that is good for Cuba. And by the way, we have 2 states here, Alabama and California, one Republican state, one Democrat state, they passed resolutions in the assemblies. And they say that they support the new moment between Cuba and the United States, and they want to see that here in the Hill in Washington. And this is a wonderful project. I don't have time to explain about this, but this was one idea. One person in Pittsburgh say, why we don't put a ring and we invite Cuban boxers to come to the Roberto Clemente Bridge. It's a very important bridge near the stadium of the Pirates. And we did it. We bring the boxers and American and US boxers, young people, were there to celebrate friendship. Of course, it's difficult to be friends in the ring, but it was a very good event, to be honest. And now we are going to do the rematch in Cuba in February. And look at these numbers. Last year, 284,000 Americans visited Cuba. That means 74% more than the previous year. And we have 329 Cubans who live here in the United States, traveling to Cuba in direct flights. So it's good. The last two polls, I promise. These are the last two. But you can see, and this is very important poll, again, from Florida International University. Remember, we have the most Cuban there. And look at the numbers. In 1991, only 14% support the lifting of the embargo. Now we are talking about 63%. And if you go only to the generation between 1996 and 2016, we are talking about 80% of support. And it's the same with the travel restriction, it's the same with the diplomatic relation. And look at this, this is Pew Research Center. And they did a polls in January, in July, and December. And look at the numbers going up. 75% in December approved the reestablishment of diplomatic relations, and 73% support ending the trade embargo against Cuba. So this was the last announcement from the president before the last that we have the last week. And according to this, this is a new directive from the president. Something that you can do right now is to bring back all the alcohol and the cigars that you want in your travel to Cuba. But people was very happy with that. I don't know why. But here was something very important. When he gave the license for American and Cubans can engage in joint medical research and expand humanitarian service to improve the life of the Cuban people. But the vaccine is not for the Cuban people, it's for the American people, by the way. So, and this was Susan Rice, the ambassador Susan Rice. When she presented the document, she said, "Now I want to be clear, the United States respect Cuban sovereignty and his right to self-determination. President Obama has been adamant that the United States has not the intention of imposing regime change on Cuba. Cuba's future is for Cuban citizens to decide." So, excellent. And by the way, you know probably that President Kennedy loved cigars. And for that reason, cigars is very important in the relation between Cuba and the United States. I don't know if you are aware of the history when President Kennedy called his press secretary and one day and say, "Buy all the cigars that you can." The day after, the press secretary came to the Oval Office and said, "President, mission accomplished. I have, I don't know, 1,000. I don't know how many. I believe 1,000 something. I have the history here." And President Kennedy said, "Okay, now the cigars and everything from Cuba is not allowed in the United States." And he signed the trade embargo. Probably he believed that 1,000 cigars were enough. History proved that were not enough. So now people are traveling to Cuba and bring back all the cigars that they can because they don't know what's going to happen. So for the last, this is our response to that directive from the president. I only want to say this. This was the official position of Cuba before the elections. And you can see that we said, after President of the United States, Obama, we hope that whoever occupies the White House has a policy that reflects the consensus of the public opinion of the United States citizens, including the Cuban immigration in that country, in favor of the improvement of relations with Cuba by the way margin. And let me say this because I believe it's very important. People who say that they support embargo to improve the human rights in Cuba, they don't know what they're talking about. Because the main violation of the human rights is the embargo. The embargo punishes children, women, all people, the whole country. You can say to me that you want to punish a whole country, okay, for different reasons, okay, but don't tell me that you are doing that to improve the human rights, because it's the opposite. So, and finally, the Cuban president, Raúl Castro, sent a message to a U.S. president-elect Donald Trump this November 9th, congratulating him for his election. So, a diplomatic approach, we don't close the door. And I have the final questions, are the same. Probably now you have more information about Cuba. Probably now you have more reason to travel to Cuba. probably now you have more reason to consider that Cuba and the United States can have normal relations. I cannot change number four. Probably in the future, you can. You have been able to say, I have been traveling to Cuba. And probably now you know if we receive fair treatment in the media more. You know how important, this is a commercial. If you want more information about Cuba, if you want more information about Cuba, you can follow our Twitter accounts. It's for free. But my ambassador, the director of United States Division in Cuba, always put all what is happening. And of course, my Twitter account. I can give you after. And this was the Pope. You know how important was the Pope in this new moment between Cuba and United States? This is the golden rule that he mentioned in the Congress when he came to United States after visiting Cuba. And he said, do unto others as you will have them do unto you. I believe that is very important. And we don't put an embargo against the United States, by the way. So, final. Change is the law of life. And those who look only to the past or present are certain to miss the future. If our dreams of yesterday are today's realities, our dreams of today will be tomorrow's realities, and thus be the same for all people of the world if we are able to dream of a better future together. President Kennedy and President Fidel Castro. So for those who want to cut the relations, I always said, they belong to the past and they are going to miss the future. For those who want to build a better future together, we can start today. Thank you so much, and I'm sorry for all the time I take.
To engage and ask,
of course,
to dialogue. And it doesn't just have to be questions. I always say when this question and answer part comes, we don't just have a question and answer period. We also have comments and whatever you can share.
So you have the floor.
So given that Cuba provides material aid to the FARC in Colombia, and the FARC is classified as a terrorist organization, is Cuba then not technically under U.S. law? 6 months from jail.
About that, that was the reason back, I believe, in the 80s, that is not happening anymore. The only thing that we provide is the opportunity from the FARC and the government of Colombia to meet in Cuba to reach peace. So there's not a single evidence that we are supporting any group, not only in Colombia, anywhere. And let me tell you this, at that time, we were proud of that. Again, as we were proud of what we did in Africa, what we did in many places. And you can see in Latin America that many of the organizations that were in those years, the rebellion are now in power. So it's difficult to say that we were not in the right side of history at that time. And now, again, we are providing the place to reach peace. The only place where FARC and government can meet today to sign the agreement was in Cuba. So we are not sponsoring terrorists anymore. Yes.
Is that most people don't know that the United States has been a sponsor of terrorism, not just around the world, but specifically in Cuba. And I don't know if people know about the case of Posada Rodriguez, who's walking around free, a person who is not just him, but a whole cohort of people who have been masterminding terrorist acts against the country of Cuba, planting diseases, blowing up hotels, one of the things that Posada Carrillas admitted to was the blowing up of a Cuban airliner in 1976. Killed everyone on board, including the whole fencing team. It was a civilian airliner. And he's walking around with impunity in the United States right now, as well as a host of other people. And this is a history that's not known. And then it doesn't even talk about the rest of the things that the United States does around the world that are really terrorist acts around the world.
So I want to introduce myself. I'm the next one. I'm the first one. I need to add that this division, we have passed this information about environmental issues because Cuba is an example to follow, and that's what it is. Water, like MPA, water is one of the things in the countries, as well as science policy in the countries. Cuba is an example to follow since it has complex water protection, while, for example, the world has only 2%. So that's something to add to the investigation. We feel very proud. We can do this every time we use it. Thanks to that, people have visited here. I only think those out. People need to learn from the data as well as people need to learn from the US. But we also have identified a lot of challenges that people face when it's about environmental protection. And that comes to, well, different psychology that ask the question. And is that, so we have some of the questions such as, we talk about fisheries and fisheries for it. And then, so those challenges we face with the agency because it's very expensive to do. So, that's one challenge that I always mentioned in the conservation of the Cuba. Two challenges that you see besides the environment that Cuba faces. So, like, you gave us a lot of data that I agree and I have been learning over the years living in Cuba. But what are the challenges that you have faced over the years that we've learned from Cuba? I know it's a difficult question. I don't want to put you in the spot, but it's like I think it's important to always learn because I have learned a lot from my work and it's time to come.
Thank you so much. It's a wonderful question. My concern is about the time I have to explain everything. And of course, I am not an expert in everything. Again, but I think it's a very good question. And I have two examples. People ask, are you affected by the crisis that we have right now in the world? And I say, yes, we are part of the world. Even when we have the embargo, if the food is more expensive, we have to pay more. And because the embargo, probably we have to pay more. And the access to technology, the access to many things that we need is not the same for the rest of the country. And some people ask to me, are you ready to live without embargo? After the embargo, are you ready for that? My personal response, I don't know. But we cannot be afraid to live after the embargo. And our goal is to put an end to the embargo. We are going to have new challenge in the future, for sure. For the new generation, it's going to be a challenge. But we really believe that the embargo is the main obstacle to the improvement of our economy. And we really believe, we are very proud of this, we can do more. And if you ask to the Cuban is going to say, no, but we can do better. And we want to change many things. So the idea is that I believe that the challenge right now is for the new generation to maintain everything that we have right now, but also to improve. And we don't know what is going to happen, not only between Cuba and the United States, in the world. And what you mentioned, we are an island. We are facing the climate change. We, right now, one of our goals is to improve the sources to produce energy. We want to achieve in the next 20 years, we want to achieve 24% of the production of renewable energy sources. Sorry for my English, probably. But that needs resources, that need access to technology, and we don't know what is happening. Sometimes Cuba has to live day by day. And this is something that people don't understand. But at the beginning of the revolution, many people say, okay, this is only 6 months. They're going down. After they say, okay, the problem is the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union is there. They received the help from the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union collapsed in 1991. And some people say, okay, the problem is Fidel Castro. Well, Fidel was no longer in power since 2006. And the people say, okay, the problem is, the same people say, the problem is Raul. Raul already said that he's not going to be in power after 2018. I don't know what they're going to say after that. But if you want to find an excuse, you're going to find an excuse. And I really believe that Cuban people has proved that the Cuban revolution is the decision of the majority of Cuba. And we can do everything that I show, because people say, okay, are you ready for the invasion of the Americans? I say, let's understand that we opened our economies in the 90s. And these numbers, these social numbers I am showing right now, is from 2 years ago, 1 year ago, 3 years ago. So we know what are our priorities, and we know what are our goals. Of course, again, in the new generation with the new problems that all the countries are facing, let's see what happened. But right now we have global concerns, not only for Cuba, for the world. Thank you.
Let me see how you get your number, okay? My hands are going up. You're number one, number two, number three, number four, number five, number six. What you got? Can you remember your number, please?
Thank you for doing
that. My pleasure.
About there's this information about the freedom of speech. Problems about freedom of speech because that's a powerful thing.
Yes.
And what are your expectations to move from here?
Okay. Thank you so much. Very question, I know. Well, about freedom of speech. Go to Twitter. Every so-called dissident in Cuba has a Twitter account. Some are very famous to have independent
newspapers in Cuba. They are not in prison. They are the only people that are being arrested or they can be able to tweet. You can read tweets that say, I have been arrested. I don't know how they are so good that they can tweet in the same moment that you are being arrested. You can try to find information in any major media. You are not going to see that somebody disappeared in Cuba, that somebody was shot, that somebody, nothing like that. The mayor, and for those people, this is a way of life. They are traveling around the world. They are coming here to the United States. We don't have freedom of speech in Cuba. No, but it's happening in Cuba. And this is interesting. I read the other day from a professor here in the United States that say, okay, we are not talking about hundreds of arrests, of people arrested in Cuba. We are talking about the same 20 people every week. Of course, if you put the same 20 people for 5 weeks, you have 100 people. But it's not 100 people. It's the same 20 people every time. What they do, they know that nothing is going to happen to them, and they sit down in the middle of the street to do public demonstration, to obstruct the traffic. What do you have to do? You have to remove those people, send it to their homes. Because even they don't have the support of the majority of the Cuban people. So people, you have to protect those people. But again, if you want to talk about freedom of speech, they have all the opportunities to go and say what they are not being arrested for what they say. They have been arrested for what they do. And the most of the time, again, the majority of them, and I can share with you, this is something I always use. I will share this with you. This is WikiLeaks, and from the New York Times. So it's not Cuban sources. And you can read what the person that was in charge of your embassy in Havana said about the so-called dissident in Cuba, how they describe the so-called dissident movement in Cuba. And he said in this document that is public, you can read it, that people in Cuba don't know who are the dissidents. They made secret polls among the people who wants to come to the United States, and people don't recognize the so-called leaders of the dissident movement in Cuba. And in this same paper, he said that the majority of those so-called dissidents are more worried about the leadership that in order that worry about to do something in Cuba. So they are worried about to be the leader for the future of Cuba and not now to do something in Cuba. And the majority of them are the people who comes here to the United States and say that they want more embargo, that they support the embargo. So how can you explain to the people in Cuba that is suffering the embargo that you are supporting the embargo? So again, freedom of speech, nobody is arrested in Cuba for that. Nobody disappeared in Cuba. Nobody is shot in Cuba for that. But of course, if you violate the law and you made a public demonstration, you sit down in the middle of the street and you obstruct the traffic, we release all the so-called political prisoners after we establish diplomatic relations with the United States before even we send some of them to Spain. What happened? Oh, they create new leaders. The majority of them wants to come here, to live here. So they are not independent leaders. Trump. And in this case, I have to say what I always said. I am a diplomat. I am working here for the best of both countries. I really believe this is what the majority of both countries want. And it's good for both sides. So our official position is what you read. We don't know what's going to happen, for sure. But our position is that we are ready to keep the same path that we start on December 17th. That doesn't mean that we are going to change our ideas, that we are going to change our principles. That means that we are going to keep fighting for the end of the embargo, for Guantanamo, for everything. But in the middle, we can find opportunities, as I mentioned, to work together. That is the position. Thank you.
So I would want to ask two questions. One, what Cuba's alternative diplomacy, so state diplomacy, the entirety of the Cuban peace the Soviet Union, during this past period, and medical diplomacy, what do you think that would look like? One is specific in Georgia. And then two, again, at the end of the world, what do you think Cuba's English? Cuba's leadership in conservation would look like once the tourists come flooding to the country. An excellent example is Cuban sea turtles
have an excellent situation right now because of the new language. As soon as you open up those borders,
what is that going to look like and how can you maintain that leadership?
Let me see if I understand everything. Sorry, it's my fault. You say about the space diplomacy you mentioned?
Yeah, so Cuba has been fantastic about engaging in forms of diplomacy that are not traditional. They've mm-hmm. engaged, so the Venezuelan trade is almost entirely based on the oil mm-hmm. program. So what will that look like going forward once the embargo is
lifted? Okay. About this. That is something that we call cooperation. And we have been doing this since 1959. So I believe if we have more resources, we are going to improve the possibilities to cooperate more with the world and the opportunity to do more projects like this. And as I mentioned in my presentation, we did it with the United States in Africa against Ebola. We provide doctors. The only country that can provide 400 doctors was Cuba. And the United States provided facilities, provide some of the resources. And we showed that was good, we succeed. That doesn't mean that in Cuba, everybody was in favor of that. That was a big debate. People was scared about the bring back the disease and everything. So, but the majority support this. And now everybody's proud of that. So I believe that in the future, without the embargo, we are going to continue doing this because we believe in that. And it's the same with the medical cooperation. It's something that we have been done. And to be honest, you can read about our involvement in Africa. The Soviet Union was against what we did in Africa. And we support Angola, even against the will of the Soviet Union. And so it's part of the culture that we have right now, even when we don't have enough resources. So if we have more, I believe we can help more. That is my idea about that. About tourism, we, in the last years, we received 2 million of tourists every year in Cuba. 1 million come from Canada. Now we are talking about 4 million. Of tourists. We don't have enough rooms in Cuba anymore. And probably we need to build more hotels. We need to, but that in our idea so far, right now, 2017, that doesn't mean that we are going to change the way that we do this. That doesn't mean that we are going to open all the spaces in Cuba for tourism. To be honest, we are trying to promote the cultural tourism. So people go to Cuba and not only goes to the beach, go to the city, learn from the history, engage with people. So that is our philosophy, that is our approach right now. And that is what has the support of the majority. Even for the people in Cuba, you know, you can imagine how many changes we have been doing in the last year in order to protect the beaches in Cuba. People don't make constructions in Cuba for many reasons, not only to protect the beach, it's also because the climate change is going to bring water to those places. So that is the idea.
I just have a commentary to offer. Mm-hmm. The contextual history between the U.S. and Cuba is very important and very unattended to subject. If people are interested, I highly recommend you read about it. There's a really excellent book that was written by a Cuban scholar named Miguel Fraga called The Cultural History of Cuba During the U.S. Occupation. And it gives a lot of context to understand the dynamics that are occurring right now. And once we understand how the parallels of history are in some ways repeating themselves, but also changing, I think that will give us, as US people, better understanding of what things about to move forward for the media and
Thank you so much. I only want to add
one thing that I always mention every time I have this opportunity. If you go right now to Cuba, you're going to see that despite all these 50 years, Cubans don't hate Americans. If you go right now and say, I am from DC, people is going to ask you, how about the nationals? What is happening? What do you think is going to happen? Everybody in Cuba has an opinion about the United States. If we as Cuban, we know about two things, baseball and US policy. But we made a distinction between the US people and the US government. So you go right now and you're going to see hate among the Cuban people. So I really believe that we can work together. Thank you.
So, what number you are?
Five,
okay.
My name is Felipe, I'm a Brazilian national. And my question to you is, what role do you think the immigration between Cuba and the other Latin American countries has had up until now in pushing the U.S. since we started the diplomatic relations with Cuba? And also, how do you think that Cuba and the other Latin American countries can overcome hindrances to immigration that sometimes come from ideological positions from the Latin American countries? So I can give you one example. In Brazil, we've been recipients of Cuban physicians in the program Mais Médicos,
yes,
translated to more doctors. And after the impeachment of our president that belonged to the Workers' Party that had an ideological position with the Cuban government, there are now talks of teasing that program. I don't know at what stage that is right now, but the point is that the mood has changed in relation to that program. So the question is, how do you think that Cuba and the other Latin American countries can overcome these sort of ideological differences that sometimes are a problem for immigration?
I think there are very good questions. And about the first one, probably you need to remember the first America summit in Miami. Cuba was not invited. No problem. Many things changed after that. And in the one before the last summit, the countries, many governments, not only in Latin America, just in Cartagena, and also the Caribbean, say, we are not going to have another summit without Cuba. So, and we are not talking only about the left governments, we're talking about a consensus among all the governments that say, okay, we are not going to have another summit without Cuba. And about that, I know that this is a concern, but you saw the vote in United Nations. We're talking about the whole world. So the pressures not only come from America, and even countries that don't have left wing governments have relations with Cuba. As a matter of fact, when we reestablished diplomatic relations, the only country that did not have relations with Cuba was the United States. The rest of the countries in Latin America and the Western Hemisphere have relations with Cuba. So how are you going to say that you're going to go back? What are you going to use as excuse to say, no, we have to cut the relationship? No. And right now, even when people don't have this information I present today, people know that in many issues, what the media said is not true. And people don't believe anymore in the majority of lies. The only thing that they have right now is about the human rights. But the rest, people don't believe in that. And about the other question about, in the case of this Brazil, and we had the same when you had this coup d'etat in Honduras, you remember that? And the problem is, how are you going to say to your people that you are not going to have the doctors that they need? And for Cuba, it's not an ideological issue. So we have been working with all the countries that need our help. So I really believe that even when countries don't want, or governments don't want to have relation with Cuba, the majority of the people there support relations and knows that cooperation is good for both sides. And right now we still have the doctors. Probably they can change that, but at the end, in the long, they cannot provide that health care to the people that need that help, and they don't have reason to say, okay, no, we don't want the Cuban doctors here anymore. So it's very difficult. But in the point of view of Cuba, we are there for help. For that reason, we didn't after the coup d'etat, we keep the doctors there in Honduras working, and we did the same in Brazil, because Cuba believed that this is for the good of the people. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Maybe two questions.
Sure.
I'm just curious. The first one is, there's this change on your way. I know, like, now dealers, there's restaurants, there's some private businesses now allowed. So I guess my question is, what is available? I mean, what's happening in that realm right now? What's policy going forward Cuba officially, both within Cuba and then, is it not much happening until they harvest in the U.S., but also should, what's happening with U.S. and businesses? And particularly, is that creating difficulty in society? Because I don't know exactly the history, but how there was sort of like a socialism where there was no private business, but that would create some friction where there's not going to be some absence and whatnot. What could they, business standards on that?
Thanks for the question. The problem is sometimes difficult to explain everything in a few minutes. But yes, we changed many things in the last years. As I explained at the beginning, 10% of the labor force in Cuba right now work in the private sector. 10% of the private of the labor force work in the private sector, and that make changes in the life in Cuba. But in our opinion, we know that there are things that we are not going to privatize. Education, healthcare, and we are open the opportunities for a small private sector that we believe is going to improve the economy in Cuba, but not the big economy, you know. And of course, we are giving more space to the foreign investment, of course, with respect to our sovereignty, to our laws in Cuba. And we need to, and again, this have the support of the majority of the Cuban. So this is not coming because the government decide to change one day the everything. No, this is because the government tries to to make change to what the majority of people asked to change, you know? And in this private sector, these casas particulares and private restaurants, that was something that the people wants to do, you know? And in order to not create more difference, probably you know that these are the people that for the first time are paying taxes in Cuba. We didn't know what was the taxes before, but now the people who has the private business has to pay taxes. And those taxes go to try to keep running the healthcare, the education, to try to create, to improve the economic life of the whole population. And that is the idea that we have right now. What is going to happen in the future? Again, we are giving more space to the foreign investment, but in key business that we believe that are going to improve the economic life of the people in order to improve the social life of the people. So it's not going to open the door to everybody to do what they want. I mean the foreign people ask me, are you going to open McDonald's in Cuba? Are you going to open? No, that is not the idea. Never was the idea. But of course, we have two hotels right now by a U.S. company. The main airport in Cuba is running by a French company. So we are giving opportunities, but always that complies with our regulations and in order to improve the life of and the economy in Cuba. So that is the general idea. The general idea. We are open to more business, but always defending our priorities.
And is the idea that more businesses with the U.S. in terms of bargains?
The problem is that you need a license to do that. For example, 2 weeks ago, yes, you need a license from the U.S. government to do business with Cuba. And there are a few, for example, products that you can buy in Cuba and bring back to US. And one of them was the charcoal. Yes. For the first time, they allow to people here in the United States to buy charcoal in Cuba to bring here to sell it. And this is a very, very green charcoal. And now we are exporting for the first time 40 tons of charcoal to the United States. It's something small. They don't allow to us to export rum or cigars. We cannot do that. We want it. Or probably biotech products that we have. Or probably another things. But we need the license from the U.S. government to do that. Yeah.
Sure,
that list of all the countries that support Cuba,
too. Yeah.
Then why is
embargo? Yeah.
Probably we need more.
Yeah, I want to do because it's also short, and I just want to end it. So it's really that's why a lot of us refer to it as a blockade and not embargo, because it's what we call extraterritorial. So mm-hmm. The United States imposes laws that not only restrict the U.S. from and people from trading between U.S. and Cuba, but from other countries being able to trade with Cuba. And to do a simple example would be a ship coming to the stops in a port in Cuba can't stop and dock in the U.S. for like another to
six months.
6 months. And so that's a very expensive thing to not be able to send the ship and be able to make real stops. So those are the kind of different ways that they impose the blockade around Cuba. And so that's why other countries will favor it, but may not be able to actually do certain things. And companies also, they fine companies for doing things like small things. If a part is made in Cuba, it can't be. You can't use this part to put in your manufactured goods. Things like that. And so a lot of what people, and then this is the last thing I'll say on it, assume are Cuban restrictions are not. They're restrictions of based on U.S. law and the blockade and how they enforce it.
Right, exactly.
They're defined and they want to get the restrictions and they can't afford. So I have you, right? And then you, and then if there's any like two more people, that's it. Okay.
Please.
Question out of left field. I'm a former diplomat as well. I was kicked out of the State Department for being yesterday in Vietnam in 1971. probably the only State Department official that subscribed to Grandma while I was in state and the Black Panther newspaper. In fact, I got radicalized because I was in Latin American political affairs, and I every day the NSA and the CIA translates speeches, press, everything from Latin America. So every day I'm sent the speeches of Fidel Castro. I'm reading this Fidel speeches in State Department. It's part of my job, right? Anyway, it had a lot to do with radicalizing and learning about how to raise cattle and learning about how to raise chickens, because of course Fidel was teaching the people of Cuba everything in his speeches about how to have a country, how to have an economy, how to have a government. Anyway, later I got radicalized even more and I became a Maoist, and I'm still a communist in a small city. And of course the theory is you go from capitalism to socialism to communism. And communism means the actual falling away of the state. And my real problem was, say, China and the Soviet Union, et cetera, they never made any move toward communism. They stayed socialist, owning the great industries and so on. And I was wondering if in the private sector in Cuba today, whether there is an attempt to move toward real communism, in a sense, employee-owned businesses, credit unions, co-ops, cooperatives, which to me, that is communism. It's the people themselves, the workers themselves, are owning where they work, deciding who their bosses are, what policies they take within their businesses. I was just wondering if this is going on in Cuba.
I believe that we have to change many things, because that was part of the challenge that we face, to be honest. But the idea was always to protect and to defend the same ideals, the same principles. But the problem is, you cannot say that you have communism in Cuba, because it's not true. What we have right now is an economy that is socialism, and we want to improve that. And we want, but the problem is that we are trying to, we are creating, and we are going to a place that is going to be new. Who knows what is the communist? So every time that people say, no, the communists fail in the Soviet Union, that was not communist. Not at all. And the condition that we had when we started the revolution were very unique, as was in Russia, as was in China, as was in many, many countries. So the idea is that the majority of the people support the idea of the equal opportunities for everybody, of the no create difference among people. That is, but in order to be able to create a communism we need to improve many things. And we need to also create the conscience in people. And with this new generation that don't know what it means to live in the Cuba of the 80s, it's a challenge. So that is my small approach to this big problem that we have right now. But also, again, I always say the embassy that we opened in 16th Street is the embassy of the people of Cuba. It's still the embassy of the Fidel, of Raul, of the revolution. We didn't change that in order to raise our flag there. So we still believe that we are going to be able to continue in the same path and to improve. But it's not what the classic wrote, you know?
And then there are iterations with more cooperative forces.
Thanks for coming.
This was really great. One of which, as you said earlier, about Cuban people actually talking to Americans. Mm-hmm. I just want to share the piece that I experienced that as well, that everywhere I went in Cuba, the Cuban people made sure to say that they don't have any Muslims, the Americans. It is the US policy administration that are Cuban. And I feel that it's such a strong sentiment to hear from Cuban people. And so, as you do this presentation process, I'm sure I hope that that's going to be nice to see folks to see them. So the question I have for you is around the way kind of put a draft of the process. You know, the complexities around the embargo and how the U.S. has gone about the policy, and there's the complexities around immigration from those who touched this land, which is even one place. So I know you're on Twitter a lot, and I just want to get a sense from you, what are your thoughts with this policy, the importance of the president, whether you see this impacting the public opinion for both the Cuban people and the American people, because it's supposed to be such a good
wonderful question. The problem is, it's not the idea of my presentation. It's something that is for people who knows more about this. But I can tell you, I remember one time, one journalist from CNN asked to our foreign minister of Cuba, what is happening that Cuban escaped from communists in wrath to US? And he said, well, one second. What about the Mexican? What about the rest of the world that comes to US? They are escaping from communists? No. So this is not political. And if you read what some people is saying right now in the US Congress, after all these years, they are start recognizing that this is not a political refugee anymore. We had this Cuban Adjustment Act that says that you come to US and you are a political refugee because you come from Cuba. And with this policy, wet food, dry food, if you put a foot in the border, you go to the embassy and ask for apply for a visa. They deny the visa, but you came in the raft or you put a foot in, and you are welcome. So that was something that, of course, encouraged people to emigrate. And the American dream was not created for Cubans. It's something that many people comes to improve the economic life, but the only immigrants that were able to receive all the benefits were the Cubans. So that creates in a real problem to have a safe, legal, and order immigration between Cuba and the United States. And by the way, the immigration between Cuba and the United States don't start in 1959. Our national hero was here in the United States in the 19th century doing the coordination for our independence war in Cuba. And we created the first factories, cigar factories in Tampa back in the 19th century. So it's nothing new. You can read probably about the some people that their fathers came before 1959, not now. So it's nothing new, but after 1966, 65, when the US Congress had this Cuban Adjustment Act, for the first time, was very easy for a Cuban to come to United States. The most interesting number is that 13,000 Cubans that comes to United States in the last 2 years has going back to Cuba, has returned to Cuba to live in Cuba with the benefits that they obtain here in the United States. So our idea was always, if you want to promote a safe, legal, and order immigration, you have to remove this policy and you have to remove the Cuban Adjustment Act. And for that reason, we celebrate this announcement. And we really believe that it's going to help to prevent people that emigrate being part of the human traffic, because, you know, was part of the human traffic. So we really believe, of course, the law, we need Congress to change that. But at least the policy, the idea that you don't have to go by sea because you're going to be welcome, that you need to get a visa to fly, to come here, okay? And you don't have any special privilege here. And I always say to the people, the only people that you are not going to see asking for an immigration reform here in the United States are the Cubans. They don't need an immigration reform before. They have all the benefits. They didn't have to hide. So I really believe that in order to normalize relations, we need to normalize this relation in the model of the immigration. And this was a step in the right direction. Of course, for many Cubans, this has been a huge change because they want to improve their economic life and they have all the opportunities here. Because remember, we are talking about the high education, immigrants with high level of education. So people who came here have all the opportunities to work because they obtain the permission, they obtain everything. they have help, economic help. So that encouraged people to emigrate. Now it's not like that. And it's going to help.
Just add really yes. quickly a bit of history. In mm-hmm. 1994, a U.S. intersection in Havana yeah. memo was leaked to the Cubans, and they passed it around the United Nations. And in the U.S. intersection, which was equivalent to the U.S. Embassy, they were actually admitting that it was only supposed to be classified memo, admitting that how they were having difficulties tailoring the requirements for political refugee status, the people were mostly falling under economic refugee mm-hmm. status, and they were doing everything to manipulate the requirements, but they were still failing in getting their quota for political refugees. I mean, this is the kind of stuff that was happening along with mm-hmm. the Cuban Adjustment Act. And so, it's admitting this. But anyway, it's these are the kind of things. And the memo, if you want, it's on the website, the organization we call it, nowaronCuba.org. And we have the text, the actual memo itself, and how they were saying how they were, and then they were being prone to direct paying people, and people prone to hustling the U.S. government in order to get their, you know, status and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah. Anyway, thank you, Miguel.
Thanks to you. Thank you.